salvation is received. Jesus, hallelujah. Jesus the Christ, the Holy One. Say the name.
Jesus.
Say the name.
Jesus.
Declare the name in this atmosphere.
Jesus.
Shake the atmosphere.
Jesus.
Jesus. We call upon the name of Jesus. The Christ, Jesus. We whisper the name Jesus. We call the name Jesus. We shout the name Jesus. We hail the name Jesus. We worship the Holy One, Jesus. We bow to no other name but the name of Jesus. We glorify the name of Jesus. All honor, blessing and dominion, salvation belongs to our God and to the Lamb, the one who has overcome by the shedding of his blood. Thank you, Jesus. In this atmosphere, we give you thanks. For all you are, for all you remain to be, you stand eternal. Hey, Lamb slain for us,
for my shame. Could this be deserve Jesus. You deserve Jesus. All of the praise, God. All of the glory. All of the honor. All of the blessing. All of the power. It is yours. It belongs to you. And so we declare this morning, you deserve it all. You are worthy of it all. Worthy, worthy is the Lamb who was and is to come. Let all the nations rejoice, and let Barbados find her place among the nations, rejoicing before our God. For she was made a praise unto our God. For did he not say that the islands will praise him with a new sound? And we declare, Barbados, it is your season. It is your hour to lift a new sound before the Lord. It is your hour that, like a trumpet that has been cleaned and prepared, that you would release your sound in the earth. Father, we pray and we call forth this mighty nation that you have called by your name, that you have appointed to be a sheep nation, God, for all eternity. Father, we highlight our home this morning, and we call Barbados into her identity as seen through your eyes, God, that she would be a nation filled with righteousness, God, that she would be a nation filled with justice, God, that she would be a nation that would provide a platform for your throne and your authority, God, to be felt throughout the earth, that she would be a lighthouse nation. We say, Barbados, you are a lighthouse nation. You are a revealer of the glory of the Lord. For the Lord will cover you with his glory. The Lord will release a new praise out of your lips. Barbados, you will mourn no more. Barbados, you will groan no more. For the Lord will appoint shepherds after his own heart in the midst of you. And you shall come forth like the dawn. You shall shine bright like the gem that you are. For I have called you not only the gem of this region, but I've called you as a gem in the earth. Hallelujah. And you shall shine and you shall reflect me. You shall resound my glory, says the Lord. And so, Barbados, we speak to you today and we say, arise. Come forth without spot. Come forth without wrinkle before the Lord. For you have been called by his name. We declare that every gem that is hidden in the midst of you, your potential, that it will come forth in this season. We declare that the enemy would not stifle your potential no more. But everything that God has given to you shall erupt in this hour. We speak to the springs within this land, the springs of blessing, not only within our tourism sector, but within our small business, our entrepreneurial sector. And we say, come forth in the name of Jesus. Ingenuity, inventions, witty ideas that will set this land, hallelujah, on a new dimension of operation. Father, if you could have given us a man from this land who would have set the foundation for search engines all across the world, Father, whom Google and those other big names would have had to learn from, surely again you can do it in this hour. And we call forth, God, our intellectual enterprise. We declare that as a land, Father, people will come forth, God, not just with head smarts, but with practicality. And God, inventions from heaven would come into the earth through the gate that is Barbados. And so we declare, oh God, to every student, to every person, God, to every working individual, that Lord God, ideas would spring forth and come alive. That Father, there would be provision from on high. That you would send to this land anointed Cyruses, God, anointed God, women of God, men of God, Father, those from near and afar, to invest and to pour in, Lord God, what is necessary in capital for our entrepreneurial sector to rise, Lord, like never before. We declare, oh God, just as California is known for its technology, just as Toronto also is known for its technology, Barbados, God, will be a key place in the earth that will be recognized in the business realm. And we declare, oh God, that there would be an export and import of human potential as never seen before, that our nation would turn into a hub of potential, hallelujah, in regards to business. We say, Barbados, arise. Barbados, come forth. We declare a people who will not stay in the shadows, but who will step out upon their ideas. God, we thank you for the dreams. We thank you for the visions that are coming. God, if you could have given Thomas Edison the idea for a bulb, Lord, for a filament in a dream, God, we believe that in this land you can speak and you can move in visions and dreams again, and you can awaken, God, a people that will not shy back. Father, we declare our people a bold people. A bold people. A bold people. Lord, your word declares the righteous are as bold as a lion. And so we declare, God, a people of tenacity, a people that are not waiting and hoping for someone to see something in them, but that would rise up understanding that they have been called to bring something to the table. Father, a people not waiting on a handout, but a people strong and mighty, called, anointed, and appointed by the living God. We say, Barbados, let your human capital rise like never before. Let your potential break forth like the dawn. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Father, that the government would not have to be so strung out, God, on having to look here and there, but Lord, there would be an arising. Lord, you're making us attractive. You're making us, oh God, hallelujah, like the sunflower in the midst of spring. And Lord, we declare bees from near and far, from the left to the right, from the north to the south, will come, hallelujah, to draw from this land, but will also, just as the bee deposits pollen and spreads, hallelujah, multiplication across an ecology, we declare in Barbados, God, that many will come and make key deposits, God. Like the Queen of Sheba coming unto Solomon, there would be such incredible deposits, God, hallelujah, of material worth that would cause, God, these ideas to come forth and materialize. And so, Barbados, we declare you are blessed. We declare that you are highly favored by the Lord. We declare that this is indeed your season to step out and to break forth, hallelujah, and not to shrink back. Hallelujah. We declare that the curtain of hiddenness has been removed and you shall come forth in your potential. Father, we speak life, Lord, to our civic, God, and judicial areas, God. We speak your life. We speak your justice. We speak, Lord God, a heart for justice in the name of Jesus. Lord, we declare that your goodness, Lord God, will come upon those departments, and that every sense of evil would be repented for, that the fear of the Lord will come upon every civic and judicial arena in this land. Hallelujah. And cause an awakening of righteousness. Father, we thank you for exposing underhandedness. We thank you once again that as you bring forth our nation into a place, Lord, where she will reveal your glory, that you are also shaking her, and everything that can be shaken will be shaken. And we declare unrighteousness will be shook out of this land. Immorality will be shook out of this land. Unfairness and injustice will be shook out of this land. And indeed, she shall shine. Indeed, she shall be the plumb line of the Lord. Hallelujah. She, Barbados, shall be the plumb line of the Lord. She shall set a standard amongst the nations of the earth. And in humility, she shall serve the nations of the earth. Father, hallelujah. We are not a nation waiting to be served. Hallelujah. God, it was indebted and placed within our people. And Lord, though plastered, God, upon our motto, Father, we say pride and industry. But God, may our pride be in serving the nations of the earth. May our pride, God, and may our industriousness, God, be in serving the nations of the earth. Barbados, remember who you are. Remember who you are. Remember who you are. And come forth as the servant and as the light of the Lord. In the name of Jesus, as the breadbasket of the Lord, not to be selfish, but to serve and replenish the nations of the earth. Barbados, we speak life. Come forth and shine. Awake, arise, and mobilize, O great nation, in the eyes of the Lord. In Jesus' name we pray and declare these things. And may the church say amen and amen. Let it be so. Hallelujah. Let our great nation come forth and shine. Hallelujah. Praise God. I'm going to ask the children to come. And even as you do take your seat, greet a few people around you. Hallelujah. Yeah. Okay. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Amen, amen. Can we just have the children just standing in a line? Just want to do something just very prophetic as we're talking about human capital and potential. And a day is just coming forth. Just bring them forward a bit. Amen. Hallelujah. Father, we want to thank you for these ones, Lord. Father, that you've called by your name. And Lord, in the name of Jesus, we declare, God, that they shall arise, God, in Jesus' name. They shall arise, God, in might and in power. Lord God, they shall arise, God, having great ideas, Lord. They will change, God, the landscape of this nation, God. Father, they will not just be looking, Father, to be served, but they shall be, Lord God, those who will serve, Lord God, anointed and appointed, Lord God, with power, with wisdom, in the name of Jesus. With incredible ability, we declare none shall be snuffed out. Father, none shall be snuffed out. No ability, no idea shall be snuffed out in the name of Jesus. That, Lord, these dreams that you have called, Father, saying that they would come forth, Lord, like the word, hallelujah, not returning to you void, that in the name of Jesus, no one of these lives will return to you void in the name of Jesus, but that, God, they will fulfill their potential in the earth. We declare in the name of Jesus that they shall be strong and mighty, that they will not be afraid of the faces of men, but that they shall be courageous, God. They shall be a Joshua generation that will arise, God, with such incredible potential, hallelujah, to take, God, what is appointed for them in the name of Jesus. And so, Father, we bless them. We bless them. We bless them. We bless them. We declare them covered, God, from every spear that the enemy would want to send against their dreams and against their potential. Father, we declare they will never be the ones that will say, I cannot. Father, they will never be the ones that will say, I cannot. But that, Lord, they would be so courageous and bold, for they are like young lions, God, coming forth. And we declare that boldness. We declare that tenacity. We declare a strong spirit, a strong mind in you, hallelujah, that will not be crushed, but that will come forth to set a new tone in this nation in the name of Jesus. And we declare, even in your environment, hallelujah, that they would know, those that would administrate and lead and teach you, that they're raising up young lions in the name of Jesus. Come on, come on. You can roar. Yeah, come on. Amen, amen. You can roar. Yes, praise God. And so we got some young lions, and we declare in the name of Jesus that their environment would be of such that, Lord, you would anoint the teachers to teach them how to hunt. That they would not live as the prey in the earth, feeling like they are the hunted, but they will come forth and they will know how to hunt, man, in the name of Jesus. They will come forth and know how to set the tone and set the pace. And so, Father, we bless them and their environment. We declare wisdom and revelation coming upon them, filling them, incredible potential being released from them in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you guys. Have a great time. Children's Church. At this time, we will have a baby dedication, and our Pastor Sandra, she's going to come. Go ahead, guys.
Hi, we welcome Janae and Paul, two of our partners, and their families will come to dedicate little Sky. God has blessed Janae. And all the family can come. Come forward if you're with them this morning. You come here because of the dedication. You can come. God has blessed this family with another addition. Hallelujah. And I understand that the reason why they have all this family is because they're also celebrating anniversary of the grandmother that passed away. So you have all, and you see Tony there smiling. This is Tony's daughter. So he's another granddaddy, another grandchild to bless. Sky, Aaron, Michelle. Oh, isn't he wonderful? If I asked Janae, were you expecting another one? She said, no. But God has surprises. God has surprises for this family. And he's so handsome. We want you to stand and just, because he's a part of this church, a part of our family, and you're supposed to be the caretakers of this little one that God has blessed this family with. Hallelujah. Father, we just want to thank you for the gift of life. Father, this little child, this son, Father, that you've blessed this family with. Father, an arrow shot out, Lord God, a seed that would impact this earth. And Father, today we declare, Lord God, your blessings on this little life, Father. Lord, I declare in the name of Jesus that health will be his, God. Father, we come against any spirit of infirmity. Father, we declare his parents without have to spend unnecessary monies, God. Father, because of infirmity. So we declare health. Every part of this body, God, we declare will develop well. We will, Lord God, he will develop well. Father, from the top of his head to the soles of his feet, every organ, every cell, Father, we declare they will function well, Father. I declare, God, that he is the head and not the tail. And Father, even as we would have heard already over the youth, the young ones, God, Father, we declare, God, that he will be a seed. Father, Lord God, release, Lord God, in this earth, Father. Lord, so we declare from a very early age, he will know what it is to serve you. He will know what it is to know the Creator, Lord God, the one that created him. And Father, every gift that you have placed inside of this body, I declare purpose and destiny, Lord God, will run him down, Father. I declare he will not go back to the ground, Lord, with purpose locked up inside of him. But he would fulfill, Lord God, his assignment, his God-given assignment in the earth, Father. I declare in the name of Jesus that he is blessed, Lord God, in his intellect. Lord, he's blessed in his body. I declare, Father, open doors, uncommon favor will run him down from every area of his life, from nursery right up, Lord God, to university, God. I declare he will do well. I declare he will do well. Father, I declare he will not be influenced by his peers, but he would influence his peers, God. I declare, and he would give good influence, Lord God. Father, we cut off any generational curses from off of his life. Any generational curses, any generational sickness, anything that will slow him down, we cut it off now in the name of Jesus. And Father, we bless him. Bless his parents. Father, give them insight of how to raise this child up with the fear of the Lord and the grandparents and the godparents. Father, the family members, Lord, truly, that their lives will be examples, God, of righteousness, Father. They will live as he looked for heroes. Father, he will not go outside of the family, God. First, he would put you as the greatest hero, and then he would model after his family. Father, he would understand his calling as a family member of Brathwaite, God. Father, and he will live it out. Father, I pray, God, in this hour, you would give them wisdom, because we need wisdom. Father, with all that is happening around us, we give him, Lord God, give the parents wisdom of how to raise, not to curse, but to bless this child, that this child will become a blessing to the parents, Father. So we lift him up to you, calling him and naming him Sky Aaron Michelle, God, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And Father, we anoint him, God. We anoint him, Father. His very head, Father. Lord, his ears will be attuned, Father, from an early age to knowing. His very breath, Lord God, will be governed by you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. Hallelujah. Awesome. Still amazes us all the time when we can produce after our own kind. Amen. We just want to welcome all of you who are worshiping with us for the first time. We want to just bless you. We want to say a prayer. And if you're with us for the first time, we want you to stand. This is not to embarrass you. This is your first time in New Dimensions. We want you to stand so that we can pray for you, we can bless you, we can lift you up in prayer. So we ask you to stand. Our partners and friends, they're going to come to you, and they're going to love on you a little bit. They're going to greet you. There's a pen, a gift of a pen, and then the leaflet is just for you to know about our ministry and any comments that you have to make. But don't sit. If you're here for the first time, and I'm going to ask Minister Al. Minister Allen is back from his honeymoon. I'm sure Apostle would welcome him back, welcome back Mr. and Mrs. Howard. And isn't he looking good? Yes, he is. He's going to bless our visitors. He's going to pray for them. God bless you.
Amen. Father, we want to give you thanks this morning for your presence. And Lord, that we can come into your presence where your word declares that there is fullness of joy. And God, for every person that has visited us this morning for the first time, they've walked into this sanctuary. Lord, we declare an overload of joy into their life. Lord, where there may have been sorrow, we declare joy today. Where there may have been some struggle, we declare joy today. And Father, I thank you that even as they have come in, Lord, that the presence of God, your presence being here, Lord, would reach into their life. And Father, that they would understand and know that you are the source of everything they can hope and believe in. God, I declare that as they leave this place, Lord, they would take your presence with them, Father, back into their homes and their schools and their workplaces. Lord, that as your presence goes, Father, they shall see and behold the goodness of God in their life every single day. So, Father, bless all of our visitors in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. God bless you. Elder Harriet, she's going to come now and finish our housekeeping matters this morning. Welcome, Elder Harriet.
Hallelujah. He deserves all of the glory, all of the praise. Hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. Amen. Oh, man, I tell you, he is so good. He is so good. Don't you get excited about just who God is? I tell you. Good morning to all of you, and welcome to the service again. And I'd like to share just a couple of announcements with you. Just to let you know that we meet here on Wednesday evening coming for a very special service as we conclude our Bible study on the gifts of the Spirit. And this Wednesday evening, we are going to recap in the sessions over the past weeks. And it's going to be a very special time. I think Apostle himself would like to tell you about that special time. And so I'll leave that to him. But we do meet here on Wednesday evening coming at 6 o'clock in the evening. And also our forerunners, the young and the very young at heart, meet every Friday evening except the last Friday of the month at 6 o'clock in the evening. Our New Life class concluded yesterday with water baptism. And we'd like those who 17 persons who were baptized yesterday. If you're in the service, would you kindly stand? 18 persons. We wouldn't want to exclude that one person. God bless you. Anybody else here in the service? You're one of 18 this morning. The two of 18. Hallelujah. The Lord bless you. We celebrate with you your water baptism this morning. God bless you as you continue to walk this journey with the Lord. God bless you. I'm going to invite two ladies to come at this time as we continue our announcement. I'm going to invite Danielle Norris to come and Paula to draw close. And as I share this announcement, the men are asked to meet on this side of the sanctuary up front with members of the men's ministry immediately after the service. And also the marriage ministry wants to thank all those who attended the treasure hunt yesterday. It was a great day, and congrats to all of the winners. Are the winners in the congregation this morning? If you went on the treasure hunt and you won, would you please stand? Hallelujah. Well, God bless those who went on the treasure hunt and they won. Bless you. Continue to hunt for treasure in your marriage because it's there. The Lord bless you as Danielle comes.
Good morning, church. I have a very special announcement on behalf of the Four Runners for Christ. We are having an excellent event called A Splash of Talent, a night for all ages. Sorry, ladies and gentlemen, we want to see not a few of you, not some of you. We want to see all of you there as we celebrate God by giving him our talents and having an excellent, excellent show. Now, usually our talent shows are extremely amazing, so we're inviting you all to come out. It's November 25th. It starts at 6 p.m. We have some special names here that will be performing. We have our very own Leanne Paris, who will be doing a spoken word. We also have the dancers from Universities UCCF coming over. And we also have an upcoming artist, Cherise Richards, who will be performing for us also, along with some other amazing, amazing things. We have Janelle, we have John Yard, we have our own Elena who will be singing for us also. So we're looking forward to see you all there. There will be food and beverages on sale. Ladies and gentlemen, come hungry, leave happy. We are looking forward to seeing you there. Bring also, amen, amen. Bring also something, just a little something for the offering. These funds are all going toward our One Thing trip in December, guys. And if it's one thing we look forward to at the end of the year is having a new encounter with God at One Thing. A group of us are going up to Kansas City. So that's what your funds will be assisting us with. Ladies and gentlemen, we are looking forward to having an excellent time. So mark your calendars 5 days before Independence. Wear some Independence colors. I will actually have the privilege of co-hosting the show with our very own Dwight O'Geese, Mr. Militant Man himself. So this will be super, as we say, lit and forever turned up. So I look forward to seeing each and every one of you there, okay?
Hallelujah. So that's on Friday evening at 6 o'clock in the evening, and you're gonna have an awesome time here. Come hungry, leave happy. Amen, amen. Paula, please come. Come full. Leave happy. Amen.
Good morning. I'm full with excitement this morning. My book launch is taking place this evening. Hallelujah. I declare that my next book launch is going to be a public book launch. By then, I will be rolling in dough. Look, rich is not in my name for nothing. Rich Arts. So I am declaring I must have a public book launch so I can invite all of you. So those of you who would have supported me by purchasing a book beforehand, or even with your words of encouragement, thank you so much. I will be in church next Sunday to distribute the books for those who have ordered. I doubt very much I will have books left back from the launch tonight. However, you can make your way down to Pages this coming Friday, 11 o'clock in the morning, Cave Shepherd Broad Street, and get your book there, because I will be having my book signing, my first ever book signing. Oh my goodness. So listen to me. You all have got to spread the word. One upon Facebook. I ain't really into the Facebook thing. So spread the word on your Facebook, word of mouth, whatever you want to do, just spread it, because Pages ain't got too much books. So I hope that all of them go too. But thank you for your support. Also, on Wednesday morning, I will be on Family Matters. Thank you, Elder Harriet. I'll be having my interview with her, pushing the book signing as well. I'm hoping to be on Life 97.5 this week. I was on CETA yesterday. So I'm doing my best to push the book signing, because the books need to sell. But thank you so much for all of your support, all of you that, I forgot. Those of you that would have pre-ordered, I am going to be calling you during the week, because what I want to do, I want to sign your book beforehand so that when you come on Sunday, it is just a matter of me distributing the books, because some of you would want it signed for a particular person or perhaps for yourself. So that's what I want to do. I may very well begin to start taking pre-orders again. It is a very, 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 very expensive venture. I am not exaggerating, but I give God thanks. I give God praise. God has been extremely good to me. Amazing. I sat down in my house yesterday morning, and I looked at all the books on the floor, and I said, then it hit me, I am launching my fourth book. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. All belongs to the Lord. So thank you, Apostle, for giving me this opportunity to speak to the church. God bless you, those that are coming to the launch. We're going to have a good time. Amen. Book signing, when? Friday, the 25th, 11 o'clock in the morning, Pages, Cave Shepherd. Bless you, church.
Thank you, Elder.
Amen. And Wednesday morning, she's where? Family Matters, 9 o'clock, 97.5 FM. Amen. Hallelujah. We get excited for each other as we accomplish the things that God would have us to accomplish. We are alive because God has purpose for our lives. And we need to be excited about those of us who are living out our purpose and seeking to live our purpose out and to be an encouragement to those who want to fulfill the purposes of God. Amen. So that when we stand before him, we hear, well done, good and faithful, faithful servant. The Lord bless you. Now, we're going to have our dollar drive, and after that, we're going to have a little bit more excitement. Amen? Come hungry, leave happy. Time for the dollar drive. Do we have the photo of the... This is where it is at this past week, November the 13th. That's where you are from filling that bottle up. Can I encourage you and excite you that we can get this bottle filled by the end of the year? Now, that area up there is pretty tough. It just looks like a short distance, but it's very wide. It's a very wide, the widest area of the bottle, as you can see. And so we really want to get that done, and so that we can bring it in on the final neck. When we get into the final neck, perhaps we'll bring it in and we can all fill it up together. The Lord bless you as you come for our visitors. This is part of our fundraising for our building program. And so you can put any currency in the basket apart from TT and Guyanese dollars. Enough respect to the Guyanese. The Lord bless you as you come. His name. We want to celebrate all of those who are having a birthday today and this coming week. Would you stand? All the birthday people, where are you? Those who are celebrating a birthday today or this coming week, would you kindly stand? The Lord bless you. We are going to, hallelujah, glory to his name. Pastor Sandra is also celebrating her birthday today. And in a couple moments, we will have the opportunity to bless her and to give God thanks for her life. We take birthdays very seriously. I take birthdays very seriously. At the end of the calendar year, we like to think about what we are going to do in the new year. But I see a birthday as a new beginning. Every time. And it's a time to take stock and ask the Lord, Lord, where have I come from in all of this time and where am I going? So let's celebrate with the birthday people. Give them lots of hugs and lots of kisses. And I wanted a birthday Caribbean style because this is November. These are independence babies.
A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you.
next Sunday, we're going to rock it up Caribbean style, okay? Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Let me tell you, the joy of the Lord is our strength. Amen. Hallelujah. Okay. At this time, Apostle, we want to take the opportunity to express our love and appreciation to Pastor Sandra and also to celebrate life with her. Life is not something that we take lightly. It is to be lived intentionally. And so this morning, we are going to take time out and just bless Pastor Sandra, give God thanks. We bless all of you who have a birthday this week. We acknowledge the goodness of God in your life. We acknowledge the purposes of God for you. And this morning, we will take time out with Pastor Sandra and just bless her. There's some persons who are going to come, and they know who they are. And I don't know if we can have nice, soft music now, something real intimate and sweet. Loving and intimate and sweet. We will do that at this time. And then we will have it open. The floor will be open for any member of the congregation who would like to come and personally bless Pastor Sandra. So at this time, I'm going to ask Ian, who will make the first presentation on behalf of the church itself. This is a gift to the from the church to Pastor Sandra with an expression of our love.
Good morning. First, let me say on behalf of the church, happy birthday to you. We declare God's blessings upon your life in all areas. You know, we thank you for being a mom to all of us. And we pray that you will live longer, good health, and sound mind. And thank you again for your firmness, but yet fairness. And have a delightful day. Bye.
We ask those who are making presentations to just come and be up front and wait your turn in line, please. All those, even if you're in the congregation, perhaps we can get everyone to just come and just join a part of the line. Let the ministries be first, and then you can join afterwards.
Good morning, Pastor Sandra. You are indeed a beautiful woman, a gem like no other. On behalf of the foreigners, we just want to say happy birthday. Thank you for being a mother to us. Thank you for showing us a great example of a true leader. We bless you and we just say happy birthday. We love you so much.
We want to say happy birthday to you from the children in the nursery and the caregivers. We love you. We declare long life and blessings, and greater is coming for you this season. Mother of the house, we just want to bless you this morning with this token of our appreciation on behalf of the intercessors. And as we declare that you have a beautiful day in God, we pray and declare that there will be many more beautiful days in your life, and that as you grow beautiful, you will grow older and even more beautiful in God.
This gift is from the Ministry of Graphic Design. We are, by business and by ministry, all about beauty and life, and that's what you're all about as well. So our gift reflects that, and we hope that you love it and enjoy it.
Pastor Sandra, you have been an inspiration to us personally. And we're taking the time on the behalf of the marriage ministry to honor you with a small token of our appreciation. We know that you deserve it. You're aging like fine wine, and we love having you here, being the blessing that you are to us. So thank you.
Hello, good morning, Pastor Sandra, on behalf of Hospitality. We wish you a happy birthday. And you're aging like a fine wine, everything. All the people aging with you are getting more younger and younger every Sunday. And bless you.
Good morning, Pastor Sandra. You look so lovely today. Oh, my goodness. You look gorgeous. I now see what Apostle talks about with that smile. I want to say from the children's ministry, happy, happy birthday. You are a mother at heart, so it's no wonder that you would be under, children's ministry would be under you. We love you. I really appreciate your genuineness. You're just a mother. I feel sometimes when you interact with me, I'm talking to my mother, and our ages aren't that far. So God bless you today, and for the rest of this year, may He just unfold all the mysteries, the secrets, the things that you've been asking Him to show you that nobody else knows but you and Him. I declare that He will reveal those things to you. He will take you into His secret place and just show you His love in bountiful ways. I declare that you will have the eyes of the eagle. Those eagle eyes will be sharpened, that you will hover over this ministry and see a thing and call a thing, declare a thing, and bring all of your children, children's ministry, and the children in this ministry into alignment unto the purposes of God.
Morning, Pastor. On behalf of the ministry live stream and web, we just want to celebrate you. We want to honor you. We pay very close attention to this date because it's a day that marks when God gifted the earth with you. We just want to pray that you continue being a conduit, an empty conduit. And as I like to say, empty trumpets are the loudest. And so, we just want to bless you as a mother, as a caretaker. We just love you.
Pastor Sandra, Lord, I'm in awe. If I was younger, I would say that when I grew up, I would want to be just like you. But this morning, I want to bless you on behalf of the Disciple Ministry, and I would like some of your anointing to fall upon me. Well, on behalf of the Discipleship Ministry, we want to give you this token of our appreciation. We love you, we appreciate you, and we declare God's blessing, long life, longevity. We declare that everything that God has for you in this life, that He will grant it unto you.
Good morning, Pastor Sandra. So beautiful. Words can't really express how much we really appreciate you and how much you're a mother to all of us in the church. So we just want to wish you a very happy birthday. May you see God's hand moving mightily in your life, continuing to move mightily in your life as a woman of God. And this is just a small token of appreciation from Projection Department. We just pray that you have a very happy birthday. God bless you.
Hey, good morning, Pastor Sandra. When I was thinking about what to say, all I could think about was how you're really like a mother to the church. You stand beside the apostle at the head of the church, and like, you, like a mother, you love each and every one of us. And I don't see your words as punishment at all. But I've always seen it as a discipline. Because I see discipline really as punishment with a lot of love. Right? You've always had our best interests at heart. And I just want to say thank you. I just want to thank you very much.
Rebecca mentioned was your discipline. And that's one of the characteristics we really like about you is your honesty and your straightforwardness, because a lot of people nowadays like to tell you exactly what you want to hear and therefore mislead you and stunt your growth. But when you are honest and straightforward and tell us exactly how it is, it allows us to grow as a person and also helps us to see the situations from a different perspective. And that's why it's so admirable that you have that trait. And also, I would never forget the advice you gave me about 3 years ago, and we were leaving to go somewhere, and you said, "Do you have your purse?" And I was like, "No." And you said, "A woman never leaves home without her purse." And I've never forgotten it, and I remember it to this day. Happy birthday.
Pastor Sandra, you are a portrait of inspiration, a picture of love. You are a collage of leadership, guidance, and greatness. And on behalf of the photography ministry, we would like to present you with a personalized photo shoot from all of us at your convenience.
Hey, good morning, Pastor Sandra. Happy birthday from the Duplication Ministry. Much love. This is our small token of appreciation. May God multiply, even duplicate, the blessings and the giftings He has placed inside of you. All right? We thank you for everything.
Good morning, Mom. This is a small token from the engineers. Yes, it's a big package, but it's a small token. When I went to get the gift wrapping paper, I could not find anything for happy birthday. And then I found this, and to think, you have on blue, just like the box is blue. So I just want to say, have a wonderful and a blessed day. You are just an awesome person. You are a diamond, right? We searched deep for you and we found you, right? Under all of that, you are just, no words cannot express how we feel about you. And you are a mother to all of us, and I love you so much.
My turn. Pastor Sandra, you wear everything on the outside. I mean, just your presence, love, strength. I always tell my sister when I see you, I feel, you know, a power coming off of you. And the closest I have been to you is when you visit me in the hospital. And the nurses say, you have a special visitor. And when I look up and I saw you, I catch four bumps. And when you finished prayer, I still had cold bumps, you know, and I felt so special to see you by my bed in the hospital. I mean, like, it really touched me. When you went along, I was still smiling, you know, and I feel fussy. So I thank you so much, you know, for thinking of me, for praying for me, all through what I was going through. Everybody actually in the church that was praying for me. And I am very thankful to, you know, be a part of this church and have met you. And I look forward to a lot more times praying with you. Thank you.
God bless you, Pastor Sandra. Continue to be who you are and who God called you to be. This is a token of my appreciation to you. God bless.
Just want to say thanks to all of you for just appreciating me. One of my mentors, a true book, that is John Maxwell, he said, just recently, heard him saying that having a birthday is just a birthday. But when you have stepped into that day knowing that you are in purpose. It is worth celebrating. And that is so true. Just having a birthday and not with purpose is just having enjoying another day. But when you step into those birthdays, knowing that you're in purpose, life breaks forth. And I just want to say that I thank God that purpose has been realized through you. Okay? But beyond you, I know that God is still working it out in me. And God is just has just been lavishing himself on me through people. 6 o'clock, I had a makeup artist come and say, I want to make you up for today. And I said, oh, Lord, I remember, and I was telling her my story. I remember when I was courting my husband and when my husband was courting me. And because I did cosmetology as well, you know, I tried to put my hand in everything. And I did cosmetology, so I know how to style hair and all of that, do your toes and all of that. But God has allowed persons to lavish their love on me, you know, and just fuss over me in this time of my life. And I remember when I was, as I said, courting him, I made up myself and I came. We were going out to a concert and he said to me, I am not going anywhere with your face like that. I love my women natural. Natural beauty, he says. I guess I had on too much makeup then. But the strong woman inside of me No, I did not take it off. I said, I am going to the concert with or without you. I am being truthful. Because I felt it was coming over like control, and I was saying, nobody's supposed to control me. And I remember Mother Hofer saying, are you going to let little makeup change, kill this relationship? Come on. And I said, no. And I went to the concert without him. I went on my own to the concert. He was singing, he was ministering. And then he came to me after and he said, can I take you home? And I said, you did not bring me. And then I realized I dealt with the God that humbles and calls us to submit. And I said, I will. But I also, you know, sometimes, God deals with this flesh. And as women, especially when you are strong women, you don't know. And submission doesn't mean that you're a doormat. Okay? Am I supposed to preach it this morning? No. But I just want to say something, that submission doesn't mean that you're a doormat. Sometimes you submit when you allow God to govern you and to tell you to submit. I never wore makeup since. Because I also understood that it was not about the makeup or the outward expression that won his heart, but the inward, the who you are from the inside. So I really want to thank you and bless you for just loving on me, caring for me, supporting me, coming alongside, kind of beautifying me. You know, I am thankful for the gifts that you are to me. And I appreciate every one of you. Every one of you. I thank God. I pray for you every day. I pray for you every day that God will also increase you and bless you, and that you will be all that God wants you to be. Because we are just stewards. There are no superheroes here. We are just stewards and servant handling the flock that God has given to us, and we're supposed to do it with love and humility. God bless you.
Now you see what I have to put up with every day. Please pray for me.
Hallelujah. We thank God. We thank God. Amen. We thank God for life. We thank God for your life. Amen. I think I'm at the place where I'm supposed to celebrate with those who are having a wedding anniversary today or this coming week, and we'd like you to stand. Hallelujah. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, there are quite a few. So let me put my glasses on so that when they put their fingers up, I can count them. Hallelujah. Oh, there, we have a problem. Okay. All right. The Blackets, how many years for you? 4 and 4? Already? Well, why both of y'all put up 4? So it's 4 years together. It's still 4. The Lord bless you. And Donna, how many years for you? 10, 20, 20, 30. Wow, the Lord bless you. You look like 35. Amen. And over here, tell me how many years. It's 36. So why are you saying it for her? They have a bigger voice. 36 glorious years. The Lord bless you. Who else? Who am I missing? Oh, hi. Tell me how many years, sister? 10, 20, 22. Glory, glory, glory. You see these years every Sunday morning? They start at 1, they go to 4, and then they're talking about 20 and 30 and 36, and we really celebrate marriages this morning. Hallelujah. So get your love, and then it will be time for us to give. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. So we celebrate today. Today is a day of celebration. Next Sunday, we are going to be celebrating our nation, Barbados, in our service. Hallelujah. Amen. It's time for us to give. We celebrate God. We celebrate His goodness in our life. We celebrate our birthdays. We celebrate our marriages. We just celebrate life today. Amen. So, Father, with hearts of gratitude, thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your love. Thank you for caring for us. Thank you, Father, that you lavish us with your love. And today, God, we worship you. We worship you with our giving, Father. We thank you that we have to give into the kingdom of God. We thank you that you made a way that we can be a part of this marvelous kingdom here in the earth. And so, God, I ask that you will bless the gifts of your people into this ministry. Bless their lives, bless their homes, bless their families, God. Father, for those who do not have a seed to give, we ask, oh God, that you will extend to them multiplied blessings in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord bless you as you give.
Your name, let heaven and earth proclaim. skies and the trees, the oceans and the seas, they worship you. The sun and the moon, the stars that light the sky, the beasts, the birds that fly, declare of you. Oh Lord, how excellent is your name.
Good morning. There is such a sweet spirit in this place. It reminded me of that song, Sweet Holy Spirit, Sweet Heavenly Dove, you know, that stay right here with us. And that's how it should be when we come into the presence of the Lord. Really, there should be no pressure and just a freeness. There's a freeness in this atmosphere today, and it's all because of Jesus. Amen. Happy birthday, Pastor Sandra. In case I don't get close to you after, God bless you. Hallelujah.
Amazed in your presence, there is nothing you cannot do. I stand amazed in your presence. There is joy, peace, and hope. There's no one like you.
There is joy, peace, and hope. Hallelujah.
glorious things. You're a faithful God. Awesome is your name. You do mighty, mighty things for me. Glorious things for me. You're a faithful God. Awesome is your name.
Friends, our God is awesome. Our God is glorious. Amen. What a God we serve. God bless all of you. A Wednesday evening, we close off our Wednesday evening services. Next week, Wednesday, is our Independence Day, and it's a public holiday. We'll have no service, and then we get into the month of December. So we've been teaching over the past, 10 to 12 weeks. We've been teaching on the gifts of the Spirit from 1 Corinthians chapter 9. And now we're closing off on Wednesday evening. So for those of you who've been coming out, we'll just recap all that we've taught you briefly. Very briefly, and then we'll have impartation, so to release you in the gifts. So you should be out to receive your prayers and activation and flow in the gifts. Amen? Look forward to that. So remember, that'll be our last Wednesday evening service for the year. Also, next Sunday is the Sunday before Independence, and we're going to have a special celebration as we thank God for the nation's jubilee. But tied to that is the jubilee of the Lord upon our lives. And next week, we're going to have an extended musical package from our music ministry, our dance ministry. Maybe 40, 45 minutes of music and dance and rejoicing. We have a reason to celebrate, huh? Amen. One God has truly guided this nation. We weathered many storms. We have reached 50 years as an independent nation. And this, I don't think I will see another jubilee. I don't think I'll be around for the 50th, so let me enjoy this one. Amen? Jesus may be back by then, so I don't know. So we're going to celebrate this one next Sunday. Come prepared to celebrate, and not the word celebrate. Enjoy and worship along with the different groups that will be singing, and also wear your colors, your national colors, and we usually say blue and yellow, but it's really aquamarine and gold. But wear your blue and yellow, something close to that, right? Wear our flag colors, and if you have your flags, bring them. Amen? Because we're going to be blessing Barbados. We'll be having decorations and rejoicing in the Lord. So I look forward to next week as we give God thanks for 50 years. All right, those of you who remember 1966 November, besides all the rain and all the stuff, remember what happened and the... All I can think about is fireworks. I was a little boy then, but there was a lot happening, a lot of preparation. It was a glorious day. So we're going to give God thanks for where he has brought us and where he's going to take us. So that's next week, Sunday. So two important days. It's Wednesday coming and then next week, Sunday. Amen. Let's get into the word of the Lord. For the past couple of months, we've been challenging you and teaching on the leadership spirit of Jesus, encouraging you as leaders, as you lead, to function like Jesus. There are many different examples of good leaders in this world today, but Jesus is the best. And he wants us to lead like him, in his spirit, the way he did it, and be a blessing to people. So we had different ministers ministering the word. Go up a bit on the monitors for me. And teaching us concerning leadership, and we hope these sessions have helped you. We have challenged you and let you know that all of us are leaders. We were born to have dominion, and in different areas you exercise influence. And all of these principles that we have taught you are applicable for your life wherever you are. Even if you have one child, it's important that we function like Jesus, and we just work upon ourselves and develop ourselves that we be like him in everything. So today I want to go into part two of qualities of a good leader. Last time I shared with you about four qualities. I want to deal with three more today. I dealt with a good leader walks with integrity, a good leader serves with humility, a good leader keeps on leading even when under fire, and a good leader understands that he's a coach. So today I want to endeavor to deal with three as the Lord will lead us. Let's see how far we get today. Next month, God willing, we'll continue on this subject. So my first point for today, a good leader understands that he is here to fulfill purpose. That is very important. If everyone is a leader, as we say, then each of us must know that we are here on this planet to fulfill a purpose. You're not here by accident. They might have told you that. They might have said, well, we didn't expect you, but God did. Therefore, he brought you into this world to fulfill something. There is purpose inside of you. You did not just happen. We are not just here in the planet passing through waiting till the trumpet sounds, or waiting till we die to go to heaven. Heaven is not our purpose for living. Wow. It's our destiny. But it's not the reason we are living. There's something you've been saved to do. It's something that God brought you here upon this earth. Why, even if you were born in Barbados or caused you to relocate here, there is a purpose for you to fulfill. And you need to establish that purpose as you seek the Lord, because true purpose is found in him. Many people are living, many people are doing a lot of different things, but they're not truly fulfilling the purpose for which they're born. Because many people today are doing what their parents told them they must do. And many people are functioning today and are very miserable. When you hit smart into your purpose, there's an excitement about waking up when the mornings come. You don't know, well, I don't feel like going to work today. I don't feel like doing this. There's something that drives you. You become purpose-driven. At night, you're sometimes up late, and you're thinking about how you can improve this thing that God has given to you, how you can make it work. You dream more, you sleep less, because your brain is always going, always trying to make things, put things in place. So you've been born to fulfill a purpose. And God wants you to understand this and to know the purpose for which you were born. So you didn't come here by mistake. You didn't come into the planet by mistake. In God's eyes, you are here for a reason. And God wants you to know it. And God wants you to fulfill purpose in the earth. Jesus started his ministry by announcing his reason for being upon earth. In other scriptures, you will hear him say, "For this reason I have come." He understood why he was here. He had a mandate from God to fulfill. And in Luke chapter 4, in verse 17 to 19, he comes back from his 40 days and 40 nights of being tempted by the devil and having fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. He came back in the power of the Spirit. He goes into the synagogue on the Sabbath day, and they handed him the book, the scrolls, in chapter 4 of Luke, verse 17. And he was handed the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." And Jesus read part of the prophecy, closed the book, handed it back to the priest and said, "Today the scripture is fulfilled in your sight," and sat down. And that created a stir. Jesus knew why he was here. He knew what his vision, what the vision of God for him was. He didn't just create a vision to exist. God gave him a vision for earth, for people, to renew our lives, to bring us back to God, to redeem man from the curse of sin, and to destroy the works of the devil. And he said, "My purpose here is, having been anointed by the Spirit of God, I'm here to preach the gospel to the poor. I'm here to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, to give sight to the blind, spiritually and physically, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to proclaim Jubilee." The acceptable year of the Lord is the same thing as Jubilee. He said, "I'm here to declare Jubilee." He knew that he was there to fulfill purpose. And he lived his life understanding this, so that anyone trying to take him away from that purpose. And when he spoke about the cross to his disciples, that he was going up to Jerusalem, and Peter got in front of him and said, no, Jesus, that will never happen, not as long as I'm alive." Jesus rebuked him, said, "No, you're not going to stop this one." With love, he rebuked him. He said, "Get behind me, Satan. You only come to stop the plans of God." I remember when Apostle Paul had determined that he wanted to go to Rome, because he felt and knew that this was the purpose of God for him. The prophet Agabus came and took a belt and bound his hands and said, "The persons whose hands are bound," and he did a prophetic action. He said, "That person will go up bound," and he began to prophesy, and the people began to cry over him. And Paul turned to them and said, "Why are you crying? I know the purpose for my life. This has not taken me by surprise. I'm prepared to do it." You see, God wants us to be in a place where we know why we are here, and we know what we are to do, and to do it with all of our might. Because good leaders understand that they're here to fulfill purpose. Good leaders give careful thought to the values and the ideas and the activities that are most passionate, they're most passionate about. And those are the things they pursue. Purpose, fulfilling purpose, means more to a leader than money. Ooh. The vision these leaders have can be challenging at times to put into action. They realize the vision only by setting realistic goals, sometimes demanding goals. And then they relentlessly go after this thing, bringing it to pass. Persistence. What is vision? Vision is a mental picture of your future. What does your future look like? Well, Apostle, I shouldn't really think about my future. No, God wants to give you a vision. I'm not talking about a vision as we read in the Bible. I'm talking about vision for the future. God wants to show you what you can accomplish ahead of you. He does not want you to live every day trying to make it happen or not knowing where you're going. God wants you to know where you're going. And he wants to give you keys and principles for achieving the thing. God says to you today, he wants to give vision in your life so that you can fulfill purpose. Vision comes from God. And sometimes the very thing you dream about achieving, and the very thing that you say, but this can be done, is the very vision that God's given to you. Because sometimes vision looks so impossible to others, and you're there saying, but it can be done. Vision is the thing inside of us that creates a desire to grow and improve. Vision embodies our hopes and ideals. It gives us a sense of purpose. It brings excitement for living. I don't wake up any morning at all bored. I'm not trying to blow a trumpet here, but it's my trumpet, so nobody else is blowing it. There is something that propels me every day because I know that I am doing exactly what God wants me to do. Yeah, I see ahead, and God has already shown me what's ahead. Not everything, but he's shown me glimpses of what is ahead. He's shown me some of the things I need to achieve. I wake up on mornings and there's a sense of excitement. It has nothing to do with how much money I have, because if God gives vision, he provides for the vision. I don't wake up saying, I don't feel like going anywhere. No. It's something that takes us forward, moves us forward. And some of you are going to have to, let me use a very secular term, some of you are going to have to take the risk in moving from where you are at and what you're doing in order to accomplish what God wants you to do. Let me put it now in spiritual terms so you can handle it. Some of you are going to have to step out by faith and move away from what you're doing to satisfy your pocket, to do what God really wants you to do. Because when you are satisfied in achieving the things God wants you to achieve, money does not come into factor. Trust me. If you can do it for free, you'll do it for free because this thing drives you to do it. However, if you understand what I'm saying, it goes beyond money. But when some of you are going to have to sooner or later, because you've been dreaming so much, and dreams are not bad. Go ahead and daydream. It's probably the Holy Spirit putting that thing in you to daydream about this thing in the future that you want to accomplish. But where you are now doesn't give you the scope and the space to achieve this thing. But you're saying, God, if I step out, would it really happen? Where will I get the money from? I can speak from experience, because I had to come to a place where I had to let go all security. All that was secure in terms of money and step out. When God said, move, when God put a vision in front of me, it wasn't easy. I had a family, but I had to step out. And I had to step out by faith knowing that the God who called me is able to sustain me. And sometimes stepping out by faith means stepping out into the dark where there's nothing to hold you. Knowing that when you step out, God will hold you. In new dimensions is a result of stepping out by faith. Some of you are coming into your purpose because I stepped out by faith. Some of you connected with what you should connect with because I stepped out by faith. Some of you met your husbands because I stepped out by faith. Your life shifted. You see, one person, just one person, you just need to step out by faith, and then things, God will begin to bring things together. I wish he would bring them all together at once and make it easy. He does not. He wants you to trust him everywhere. And then God said to me, this thing that you're doing is not about money. You have to trust me. I will take care of you. So know that when God places purpose inside of you, that thing is living. It is not something abstract. It's a living thing that causes you to view this thing and to see this thing. There's some of you sitting in this place that God has put a vision, not just for this nation, not just for the Caribbean, but for the world inside of you. In due time, you'll achieve. You step out step by step. Barbados today, Caribbean tomorrow, world the next day. Some of you are seeing the possibilities, but let me say something. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. I walk the fear line. Don't be afraid. Understand that God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we're able to ask or imagine by the power that works in us. Vision. Jesus had a vision. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1 and 2, therefore we also, since we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, vision, endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For the joy that was set before him, for the thing that was set before him, the joy of seeing man coming into his rightful place, and at last having fellowship with God. That was his vision. For the joy that was set before him, bringing things into order again unto God, the cross did not matter. As painful as it was the joy that was in his future. And he understood the process to his future was the cross, but what was before him was greater than what he was going through. So he endured the cross to get us where we're going. There are times when it comes to our vision and our purpose, we go through a lot of stuff in life. Just sometimes to birth the thing. Just sometimes because you're carrying the thing. It creates a stir in hell because the devil does not want you to achieve purpose. He does not want that vision to be fulfilled. And he will raise up the heat on you. But understand, for the joy that's set before you, go through what you're going through. When you come out, you'll be stronger and better to handle what's before you. Sometimes the process to stepping into your purpose is the cross. For those of you who are stepping into purpose, or who have stepped into purpose, think about it. Remember the things you went through? Look back at it, the stuff you went through. It was for a purpose. The purpose was purpose. And even though you were going through, you wondered, how can I make it through this? You've made it. You're stronger and you're better. You can handle the very thing that now God has given you to do, because God was building character. So go ahead, achieve all that God has placed in your hands to achieve. Go ahead, the devil can't kill you. Go ahead and fulfill purpose. He can just stir up the nest, but he can't take you out. Go ahead, fulfill purpose. He will want to discourage you, but the vision that God has placed inside of you is greater than the devil himself. Go ahead and fulfill. He will want to mess with your mind to cause you to think this thing will not be financed. It's not going to come together. Nothing's going to happen. You're going to be in this job for the rest of your life, and all you will do is keep on dreaming. But I say to you, oh no, his words are not even stronger than the vision that God has placed in you. Go ahead and fulfill the very things that God has placed inside of you. But, in the process of your planning, make every step in harmony with the Spirit of God. Do not move before your time. Vision is too precious. This baby that God has placed inside of you is too precious. Don't step outside of your time. That's what the devil may want for you. Because if he can't change your mind, cause you to change your mind by bringing the pressures, he might cause you to feel, well, nothing is happening, let me move now, and it's not God's timing. This thing is too precious. It's too precious. Vision provides motivation, and it provides inspiration. It keeps us going. It keeps us moving on. I wish I had more time, but let me continue. Vision helps to keep us moving forward and to move through obstacles. See, if a leader has a strong vision, little setbacks and little obstacles will seem very insignificant. You'll work through them. You'll persevere. You'll move to the next level of your life. But vision also provides focus. With all of life's, I call it distractions, and people vying and things vying for our attention, it can be hard at times to feel a sense of accomplishment. As a leader, acting on your vision will provide you with the focus needed to accomplish your goals. Vision provides a focus. Leaders understand that their leadership is about people. Leadership is about people. Leaders are people-focused, but leaders must also be purpose-focused. And you have to determine at times if, even though leadership is about people and helping people and developing people, you must determine at times if people will hinder purpose. Let me bring that out again. Because leadership is about people and developing people, we can get distracted by people and lose focus of vision and the purpose that's inside of us. And sometimes people can take away the very purpose because they're vying for attention. You got to know when to focus, when to remove yourself, when to refocus. Because vision will give meaning and purpose to what we do. Sometimes you have to say no to people for the sake of purpose. And other times on purpose, we have to deal with people because there are two things. Developing people, but we also need to develop us. And develop and understand the thing that God has placed inside of us, lest we lose sight of it. Vision gives us meaning and purpose to what we do. As a leader, it will help you to see the end result of your efforts. It will give you your why and the reason that you are doing what you are doing. Vision motivates you to fulfill purpose. So when you are about purpose, you don't allow people or things to distract you. However, let me say again, leadership is about people. Let me help you. In Luke chapter 4, verse 42 and 43. Now, when it was day, Jesus departed and went into a deserted place. And the crowd sought him and came to him and tried to keep him from leaving. Now, Jesus was about people. His ministry was about people. He healed the sick. He raised the dead. He opened blind eyes. He helped people, cast out demons. It was about people. But Jesus knew when it was to just pull aside and refocus and spend time with him and the Father and even rest. So he departed into a deserted place, and the crowd sought him and came to him and tried to keep him from leaving. No, Jesus, you can't leave. You've been too good to us. Look how many of us have been healed. We will not let you leave the city. But he said to them, I must preach the kingdom of God to the other cities also, because for this purpose I have been sent. So as much as you like me and want me, purpose is calling me to another city. I'll come back, but I must go to another city. So sometimes we have to understand that we cannot be distracted by even the very people we're called to serve. Secondly, I could spend the whole day on this, but secondly, probably I'll come back and build on these another time. And flowing out of what I just said, a good leader manages his time and his gifts well. A good leader understands that if he's to fulfill purpose, then he must carefully and properly manage his time and the gifts that God has placed inside of him. But Jesus, boy, I read Jesus. I just love how Jesus deals with things. Jesus did not allow people to dictate to him how and when he was to function. He took his directives from the Father, the one who sent him. That's why he said, John 4:34, my food is to do the will who sent me and to finish his work. And John 12:49, for I have not spoken on my own authority, but the Father who sent me gave me a command, what I should say and I should speak, and what I should speak. Jesus understood that he had a time limit on earth, and there was much to fulfill. So it was necessary for him to manage his time and also his abilities, his gifts well. That's why he said in John 9 and verse 4, I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. The night comes when no man can work. He managed his gifts and his time well because he was purpose-driven. And that is why when he went to a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and they ran out of wine, his mother came to him and said, Jesus, we have no wine. Do something about it. And she was actually saying to him, do your first miracle. Come on, move now. And Jesus said, woman, my time has not yet come. What he was actually saying, God determines when I make this move. You're my mother, I love you to bits, but God determines the move. I do not want to move outside of God's will, because moving too quickly can mess up things. So, woman, my time has not come yet. He understood that it was God leading him and not people. One day he was ministering to a large crowd and someone said to him, Jesus, your mother and your brothers are outside wanting to speak to you. The Bible says he was ministering to a multitude, teaching them. And this person interrupted Jesus and said, your mother and your brothers, they're outside wanting to talk to you. And Jesus listened to his response, Matthew chapter 12, verse 48 to 50. But he answered and said to them, he answered and said to the one who told him, who's your mother? Who's my mother? And who are my brothers? And he stretched out his hand toward his disciples and said, here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of the Father in heaven is my brother, my sister, and my mother. Maybe if it were me, I would have probably paused the meeting. For after all, my mother's, probably not for my brothers, but my mother, yeah. I'm speaking to a big crowd, my mother wants me, hold on guys, that's my mother. But Jesus was not distracted from his mission. He managed his time and his gifts well. He understood as much as he loved his mother, it was not the time. A lot of us as leaders are easily distracted. We're functioning here, something happens, and we jump over there and leaving this unfinished. And while we're over here doing something else happens over there, and we jump over here leaving this unfinished. God wants us to manage our time and our gifts and abilities well because they're really his to us. And we need to be stewards of the gifts and abilities and talents he's given to us. Jesus managed his gifts well because even though he knew that time was short, he did not allow himself to be burnt out. So very often he withdrew himself into a solitary place and he rested or he charged himself up by spending time with his Father. As much as his calling was for people, he understood that there was time management and gift management that he could not. He was man. Yes, he was God, but he was man. God in a body. And that he will become tired. And that if he was going and going and going and doing and achieving and feeling good achieving, but not rest, he could short circuit the very purpose for which he came. And when it was time to function, there was nothing in him to give. Leaders, you cannot be going, going, going all the time. There's something God has instituted called rest. And sleep. Sleep is a beautiful thing. This body is the temple of God and it needs rest. You cannot be involved in everything. And let me pull back from that one. Some of us are too busy and we don't get enough rest. We're burning our candles from four ends. and we're not managing our time and the gifts that God has given to us. We're not doing it well. So let me say it again. You cannot be involved in everything. As my mother used to say, you can't be at every cop fight. You have to determine which one connects with the purpose for which God has brought you into this world. And you have to learn to say no. No does not mean that you don't care about the person. No simply means you care about the time and the gifts and the purpose. So no simply means that this will distract me from what God has called me to do. I love you, I support you, but I can't. I'm invited to many things. Many things. But I have to decide which one is profitable to my time and my calling. I can't be at every event. And more so, I don't allow anyone to manage my time for me or to even control it. They can call and say, the Lord is saying you have to be there. That does not impress me. It doesn't impress me because you think that I have to be there, that you need me so much. But is it connecting with what God wants me to do? So at times, I have to say, no. I have learned the art of saying no. Because when I was younger, I was like that. Yes, let's do it. Oh, let's do it. And you call me here, let's do it. And then I suffered burnout. So when I did, the first thing that came out of my mouth was no. Because if I'm all tired, how can I give myself to what God has called me to do? I always tell people I have a vision that God has given to me. There are things I need to accomplish. And those are top priority. Some people don't like it. Some people may be offended at my no, but I cannot spend the rest of the day worried about that. Oy. You understand what I'm saying? I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. The night comes when I can't do it. My night might not be death, but my night might be old age. The energy that I had in my 30s, I am praying to come back, but in reality, you get what I'm saying? In reality, I don't have the energy of my 20s and 30s. I remind God that he said my youth will be renewed like the eagles, so I'm pressing into the eagle's anointing, but it has not come yet. Therefore, I must manage my time and my ability because night is coming when I can't do what I'm doing now. But when night comes, would I have left something unfinished? Because I was busy doing everything for everybody, but nothing for what God has placed inside of me to do. I have many invitations. I want you to come here and preach, but I have to seek God, and I tell him, let me talk to God about this one. So please understand, choose your time wisely. Night is coming. For some of us, you're still way early in your morning. For others of us, you're at midday. For others, the sun is setting. But for all of us, night is coming. And you have to use your gifts and your abilities and talents and focus on the vision and the things that God has placed inside of you so that when you stand before him, he says, well done, good and faithful servant. I might spend all my life being faithful to what everybody else is doing, but am I faithful to what he has called me to do? I'm must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. So we need to analyze how we spend our time and use our gifts. And we need to be accountable to God for our time and our gifts. You know, I'm going to have to finish this next time. Here's some examples of some of the biggest time wasters that I've watched, whether in my life or in other people's lives. I can share so many of them, but here are some. When you begin to worry about what you need to do, to the extent you begin to put it off, and it leads to indecision. Sometimes people are in a hurry, so they rush and begin to implement things and begin to do things, but have not taken time to step back and analyze it first. And then you find out we're not doing it right. Other time wasters are like procrastination. Oh, I can do this later. Then making unrealistic time estimates. Oh, I would finish that for you by 12 o'clock, but really and truly, it demands a 5 o'clock finish. And we try to impress, and we end up disappointing people. And then a big one is poor organization. I may be a big sticker for this. I may be a big, big, big sticker for this, but before I go to bed at night, I organize my next day. So I don't wake up in the morning trying to find out what I need to do. And I'm very careful what comes in suddenly to take me away from that. Or trying to do everything yourself and not delegating. These are not the days we need to micromanage and trying to do everything yourself. If you have a team, delegate. You don't have a point to prove. Your team makes you look good. Delegate. And then you're delegating, don't give everything to everybody and sit down and chill. Because there's the other end of delegating where there are things to do and you tell, oh, you do that, and you just sit down and do nothing. Give me 10 minutes, let me finish. So now I have to come back to that. Thanks for that. I heard somebody said 15. No, I only want 10. I got to manage my time. Lastly, my first point was what? If you're listening, a good leader. I'm hearing blah, blah, blah. A good leader. That's what? Here to fulfill purpose. I've heard that one. Secondly, manages his time and gifts well. And thirdly, a good leader leaves a legacy. Your legacy is not, and last time I talked about being a coach and transitioning and things like that, but I'm dealing with another side of this. Your legacy is not defined at the end of life, but rather by the moments shared and the decisions made and the actions taken and even the mistakes you've overcome throughout the many phases of your life. When I speak of legacy, I'm not just speaking of death. I'm speaking of life. If you are to retire today, or God forbid, let me throw this in here, die today, what is your legacy? What would you leave behind? What would others define you, and how would they define you and your legacy? Your legacy must not be determined by material things that you pass on to your family or friends. but by the quality of your life that you lived on earth. The most valuable legacy we can pass on to our children, our grandchildren, or other people is a spiritual legacy. The results of a life lived in Christ. The idea of legacy may remind you of death, but it's not about death, it's about life. It's about really living. It's while you're living to pass on value to people. From a very practical standpoint, if you don't pass on your life experiences by leaving a legacy, the wisdom that you have gained through the decades of difficult learning may disappear as your physical body wears out. Jesus left a legacy before he left this earth. He spent time with his disciples, teaching them and showing them by his own life how to truly live for God. He showed them how to live by faith, how to cast out demons, how to do miracles. He taught them about the kingdom and how to live a kingdom life. One day his disciples came to him in Matthew chapter 13, verse 10, and they said, Why do you speak to the people in parables? And Jesus said to his disciples, because it has been given to you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it has not been given. He was building capacity in them. He was passing on something to them. He taught them the value of miracles by speaking by faith. So one day he was passing and there was a fig tree and there was no figs on it, but there were leaves, and he spoke and cursed the fig tree. And then the disciples marveled, oh, how quickly this fig tree died. And Jesus said, that's nothing. But then he turned to them and said, if you shall speak to this mountain and tell it, remove yourself and go into the sea, and do not doubt in your heart, it shall be done. Building legacy in them. So when he left this earth, all he had to do is breathe upon them and say, receive the Holy Spirit. Jesus was passing on spiritual principles, what I call spiritual legacy, by teaching his disciples how to do things. So we as leaders must leave a legacy at every stage of our lives. We must pass on values to our peers and to the upcoming generation. We don't want to lose a generation. In Judges chapter 2, this verse of scripture always scares me. In Judges chapter 2, verse 10 to 12. After the whole generation had been gathered to their fathers, they had died. Another generation grew up who knew neither the Lord nor what he had done for Israel. Why? There was no legacy. There was no spiritual legacy. The older ones did not pass on anything to their children. So a generation grew up who didn't know the Lord. It scares me when I see the upcoming generations. And the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord and served Baal. They forsook the Lord, the God of their fathers. He was the God of their fathers, but was not their God, who had brought them out of Egypt. They followed and worshipped various gods of the people around them, and it provoked the Lord to anger. We have to do more than pray for our young people. We have to instill values. We have to leave a legacy. Because when we are gone, what will this Barbados look like? Where nowadays people are accepting any and everything for values. There is something, I don't think it's too late. Don't tell me it's too late. The Spirit of God can still transform lives. While we are alive, then you may think they're not hearing you. Talk it. Say it. It may ruffle their feathers, but let their ears hear what you are saying. Something will happen. Do not say, well, we've become these young people, they will never amount to anything. No, change that. begin to tell them they will become something powerful and something great in this nation. A lot of them at home are hearing they'll never come to anything. A lot of them don't even have the parents at home to say anything to them. Their role models are some of the worst people that we want around, because they're accepting any and everything. We in the church have to build a better Barbados by speaking into the lives of our young people and trying to save, if not all, some of the generation, so that we can have a remnant behind where the legacy is in. We do not want that when we are gone from this earth to hear about a Barbados where people don't know God. See, when we were growing up, we had to go to Sunday school. There was no choice about it. You got to go. Even if your parents didn't go, you had to go. And we who had those values, godly values, not just from parents, but by aunties and uncles and grandparents and the neighbor who lived next door and down the road, because they all taught us. A whole community taught us. Because if mommy and daddy weren't at home and you're down the road playing the fool, they correct you, pull yourself up. You may not like that. But the whole community taught us. But we who had the benefit of a whole community, because there's certain things we had to do. Some of us have dropped the ball by telling our children they don't have to. And because we did not have much, we have placed everything in their hands and they don't value things. We can change it. It's not too late. The values that we have, we could not dare be, let me use a good word, powerful to an adult. Pardon me, I don't mean to offend. They cut you backside and you go home and your mother do the same thing. So now this, we try to speak to young children and they line us in some good cursing. And we can't touch them. But the values that were taught to us to respect your elders, respect adults, even respect God, is missing from our society, but it's not too late. One day in our community, in our street, someone accused my mother, came in front of our house accusing my mother. And my mother said, "You lie." And it was back and forth like that, and I didn't like what the person was saying about my mother. So I come beside my mom and say, "You lie." And by the time the light came out, that popped. Principle learned. You can't speak to an adult like that, your child. I'm an adult, not an adult. It was beyond the lash. I ain't do it again. When adults are speaking, children can't be in the conversation talking. You get what I'm saying? Those values should not be lost. We are the ones who are well structured. Forget the legs. A lot of us have some good legs, but they help keep us straight. But there's something beyond the lashes that we can pass on. Children still need to be children. They should not grow up before their time. They should not get involved in adult stuff. If my mother and father were talking, I couldn't just butt in and talk. It's an excuse me. And if you butt out, this is adult talk. And the values of respecting others, the values of passing the street and respecting adults, the values of understanding there is a God and reverence Him, values of politeness. I still speak to people who are older than me and say, "Yes, please." Values, so those things have been passed on, and it's so refreshing nowadays to hear, not that you got to say yes, please, but it's so refreshing when you hear a young person say, "Yes, please." And I'm saying, oh. Values legacy. Now the teachers can't even tell the children anything. We pray for you, teachers. Me, I was so scared of all of my teachers that I'm a big man working. I saw my, well, my teachers are straightened up. I'm serious, straightened up. Yes, sir, you know, because they know that you, yes, sir, you have to do your salute. Oh, y'all, you don't know what I'm talking about, you. Some of the older ones, no, I just was the school I went to. Good afternoon, sir. I still call them sir. Those values should not leave us. These must be passed on to the upcoming generations, along with some deep spiritual truths. We must teach them identity, because a lot of them don't know who they are. We must teach them godly principles. We must teach principles that are based upon the word. Because in the world that they're living in, there are all kinds of things coming at them that are not godly. And sometimes the loudest voices that they have are from some ungodly people teaching them. We have to teach them godly principles. We have to teach them courage and faith. We have to teach them that they can achieve. Like Timothy, Paul reminded him in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5, of the faith that lived in his grandmother, and his mother was also in him. Because spiritual things can pass on. His grandmother, mother built legacy, built character, built capacity in his life. But Paul also told him in 2 Corinthians 1, verse 5, he reminded him to stir up, or reminded him of his sincere faith, which was first, I mentioned that already. He reminded him of the strong grace that was in Jesus Christ, 2 Timothy 2, 1 to 2. And that the things he heard from Paul, among many witnesses, commit to faithful men who are able to teach also. In other words, I taught you, you teach people who will teach people, and you build capacity. There's a legacy left. We must teach responsibility and accountability, that these things still stand. But as leaders, finally, we have to, if this thing is to work, that we are to be good leaders and effective leaders, we have to constantly reinvent ourselves. Change means invention. Each time a major shift happens in our lives, we have to determine what kind of people we want to become as a result of that shift or trial. I've reinvented myself several times in my life. I've had to, because the very experience or trial we go through, if we don't learn from it, or the mistakes we make, if we don't learn from them, we'll repeat them. Reinventing yourself means you are restructuring yourself so that you will do it differently and you will do it better in the future. Leadership done correctly is a reinvention process, a continuous discovery that informs your mindset. It brings about new skills and capabilities. Leadership is about reinvention, constantly developing yourself and building capacity, and moving from where you are presently closer to what you really should be as a leader. At every stage of our lives, we shall learn how to keep creating impact and having great influence. So when God moves you to another level, it demands reinventing yourself in the Spirit of God so that you can have greater impact, you can have more influence. And when he moves you to another stage in your life, it's calling for reinvention, or let me use a good term, transforming your life through the Spirit of God so that you can have greater impact. So that what you're doing now is not necessarily what you'll be doing 20 years from now. God would have built you up and taken you to another level. So that when you reach a senior, you must understand you may not have the energy to do what you're doing in your 20s and 30s, but you can still have greater impact as a senior. Because God shifts you, you having reinvented yourself or transformed your life throughout every stage, you have greater impact. Let me use an example as I land the plane. You may not like the example, but I'll use it nevertheless. Use this quickly and run home. Donald Trump. Now I got your attention. We know him as a tremendous businessman, a billionaire, establishing businesses. We're not going into the hows and whys. This is not saying that we support one, but he ain't my president, so it's all right. It doesn't mean anything. It simply means I'm using an example. The man is 70 years old now. He has impacted many, confused many, disturbed many, but he, in his years, had the energy to do certain things, and he built and he did well. But at 70 years old, no one will be looking at the man and say, you're 17, I'll go home and sit in a rocking chair. You served your time. No, he's seeking now how he can have greater influence. Forget all the stuff that went on. I'm talking about a man at 70 years old, does not see the end of his days, but seeing an opportunity to make greater impact. Not just national impact now, but global impact. You get what I'm saying? So look purely at the example. Nowadays at 70, we want to give people a lounge chair and tell them go home and rest. When at 70 years old, at 75, you can have greater impact. Because the people you can touch will be greater than those you would have touched in your younger years. 70, it's now over. You're now kicking in. If God allows me to reach 70, don't look at me and tell me, go home and sit down, Apostle. Because at 70, I will not be standing behind this pulpit every Sunday teaching you. I will have a global impact. I'll be reaching out to the nations. I'll be in various parts of Africa and Europe and the Caribbean and South America and Central America, teaching nations, come back home, report what's going on, teach you once or twice, but go again. I've already seen that. So that alone is keeping me alive for the joy that's set before me. So the man has become the oldest person in the history of the United States that became a president. Because he did not allow 70, a number like 70, to deter him. You got what I'm saying? Some of us at 50 and say, well, you know, no. Shift gears. Reinvent yourself. Seek ways of blessing other people. Because you're not being called to just quit. You're called to finish strong. We're not limping to the finish line. We're finishing what? Strong. Whatever age God calls, whatever number he calls you to come home or whenever you come back, we will be working hard and finishing strong and having impact and influence. So understand, leaders, you're here to fulfill purpose. Understand that you need to manage your gifts and abilities and talents well in your time. Understand these important things. Understand that you must leave legacy. But understand in the process of leadership, as the time God gives you, reinvent yourself. And move from one level to a level, one stage, getting stronger, getting better. Creating impact, having influence. Father, thank you for your word today. Thank you for allowing me the time to challenge these leaders in this place concerning our walk with you and what you expect of us. I ask you to bless every one of them today. Help us all, God, to do what we're called to do. If there's anyone, Lord, who's not seeing their possibilities, who does not understand that they're here to fulfill a purpose, if there's anyone, God, who cannot see because the eyes to vision is dim, God, crystallize it in them. Remove every scale, remove everything that hinders them. But let each and every one of us understand that purpose must be fulfilled. So I ask your blessing upon each and every one of us. And before we close off this service, is there anyone here who does not know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior? And today you say, I want to receive Jesus Christ in my life. Because when you receive him in your life, purpose can become real. Today you say, I want to receive Jesus. I want to serve Jesus Christ today. Please stand wherever you are. You're saying, I want to receive Jesus Christ in my life. Just stand right where you are. Give us that opportunity to pray over your life and to be a blessing to you. Any in the service? You say, I want to receive Jesus Christ in my life. Amen. The Lord bless you. Let's stand, please. The men are asked, please, to remember to meet over to my left, your right, with the men's committee. It's very important. Just remember, men, we meet over here to your left, your right, right after the service. Thank you for your attention to this. Let's bless you as you prepare to go. I'm giving an announcement about a human chain link tomorrow. I didn't realize it was tomorrow, from 9:30 to 11:30. This is the national chain link. It's the 28th. Okay, I knew it was the 28th. Okay. Okay. So ignore that one. Let's pray. Father, I just give everyone to you and I want to thank you for them. I want to thank you, God, that you're working in their lives and you're ministering to them. You're shaping us as leaders in this earth to create impact, to have influence, to be a blessing. I give everyone to you, declaring your grace, your peace, your blessings, your strength, your wisdom in their lives. And may they walk in the things of the Lord this week. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless all of you. Don't forget, Pastor Sandra's birthday is on Tuesday. You could give her a call and wish her a happy birthday or...